Good morning and welcome to the house of the Lord today. We're glad you're here with us, and we trust that the Lord will bless you with the ministry that your soul stands in need of this day. If you're interested, this evening at 6 p.m. there'll be a preaching service at the Waldo Restoration Branch. The pastors of Zion have a summer series going over there. I don't know who the speaker is tonight, but they usually have the air conditioning on, and they have refreshments afterwards if you're into that kind of thing and have a lot of fellowship. So far, the two that I've been able to attend, the sermons have been really good. At least I appreciated them. I know we all like different things and stuff like that. So, and I'm sure there's some other things that are going on this evening that I'm unaware of. But would put that out there for you in case you would like to do something this evening. For the call to worship, I would like to read from Psalms 104. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O Lord my God. Thou art very great. Thou art clothed with power and majesty, who covereth thyself with light as with a garment, who stretchest out the heavens like a curtain, who layeth the beams of his chambers in the waters, who maketh the clouds his chariot, who walketh upon the wings of the wind, who maketh his angels spirits, his ministers a flaming fire, who laid the foundations of the earth, that it should not be removed forever. Let's turn in our hymnal to number 18. Number 18, and we'll stand to sing this, and we'll remain standing for the opening prayer by our brother Jim Huseby.
Heavenly Father, thank you for calling us together. Thank you for your call to each one of us to hear you Heavenly Father, and we have assembled to hear you, and we've assembled to enjoy each other's fellowship. We've assembled to put our own selves and our concepts and our prejudices aside and bring ourselves into your presence, your environment. And that's our desire, Heavenly Father, that we may step out of ourselves and be ministered to by you. Heavenly Father, our brother Donny has prepared earnestly and with repentance and faith to bring what you would have us know and understand and act upon. So, Heavenly Father, we do bring ourselves before you. We ask that you would speak to us through Donny, that all may be edified, and that we might grow together and become your people together. That's our desire. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Roland, if it's more convenient, we can get somebody else to take the basket. Okay, that's fine. I don't blame you. I would too. If you'd come on, I will ask the Lord's blessing on our offering this morning. Father in heaven, we take a moment to not thank you, or to thank you for the many blessings of life, the many ways you bless our lives. And Father, I know that I don't thank you enough, was what I was trying to say a moment ago. And even in the many times I've confessed that, I still don't thank you enough. But Father, truly, you have blessed our lives in many, many ways. And thank you for that. This morning, Father, as we make this offering, I ask that you would bless it, that it can accomplish more than seemingly possible. I ask that you continue to bless our lives, Father, and help us to find ways to share those blessings with others around us, that others might learn of your goodness and love. And so, Father, we thank you and look forward to being able to bear testimony of how you work in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen.
Number 366, and we'll remain seated to sing this.
Oh, for a faith that will not shrink.
It's my privilege and honor to introduce to you today, which many of you know, some of you may even know Donny better than I do, but Donny Anderson. And most of everybody's aware that Donny's traveled a path quite a bit different than most of us have traveled. Nevertheless, it is a path that has been educational for me to share with Brother Donny. It's helped me learn a lot about myself. One of the things early on Donny shared who his grandfather was, Kenny Stobaugh. He was a 70 in the RLDS Church. And when he said that, I had to ask him again. And he said, yeah, Kenny Stobaugh. I said, interesting. It's my understanding that Kenny Stobaugh was the minister that officiated at my mom and dad's wedding. And mom always shared the story that she didn't know how Kenny had done this, but somehow he was able to keep the courthouse in Benton County, Arkansas, open after hours so that he could get registered to perform the wedding legally there for mom and dad. So it's just always been interesting to me, Donnie, that we had a connection, roundabout as it was, and it makes me wonder, you know, what goes on the other side of the veil at times. But brothers and sisters, I would ask for your attention and prayers for our brother Donnie.
Good morning. I have trouble sitting still. I have trouble standing still, so I'm going to be roaming back and forth. I know this is not usual for us. So, today I'm going to be talking about faith, hope, and love. At the end of 1 Corinthians chapter 13, Paul says, well, in the middle he says, well, where there's prophecy, prophecy is going to fail. Where there's tongues, tongues are going to cease. And where there's knowledge, knowledge is going to vanish away. At the end, these three things remain: faith, hope, and love. And the greatest of these is love. We're going to look at each one of these in turn, very briefly. Otherwise, we're going to be here until 3 o'clock. On that note, it is very, very easy to write a long sermon. I could preach for days. What's very difficult is to condense that down into something palatable and timely. And I know some of you are like, where's the 4-minute version of this? So, let's look at hope first. Within the definition of faith, we find, what is faith? Faith is the assurance of things hoped for. If we have no hope, we can't have faith. If we have no faith, we can't please God. It says it is impossible to please God without faith. So hope is foundational to faith, which is foundational to pleasing God, which is foundational to loving. There was a woman in Scripture. She had an issue of blood. Essentially, she was on her menstrual cycle for 12 years. 12 years. I can't imagine that at all. Women, good job. Good on you. Keep it to yourself. I just can't imagine. But it's worse than that. It's worse than just the pain and the discomfort and the bloating and all of the things that you're supposed to get the medicine for. It's worse than that. It is, she in the Jewish, according to Torah, Jewish law, she was unable to go to synagogue and worship. She was unable to go to the temple and worship. She was unable to hug her kids because she was ritually unclean, and if she touched them, they were ritually unclean, or her husband, whoever. It was horrible. It goes on to say that she had spent all of her money all of her money on doctors, physicians, healers, shamans, whatever, to try and get this issue of blood to go away. She had lost hope. She had no hope that things could get better. And that's what hope is. That's what hope is. What we are hoping for when we talk about hope is, first off, a perfect world. A world where there's no sin, where people love each other perfectly. But it trickles down into our daily lives as well. We hope that things in our own lives will be better. If we don't see a way out, if we don't see a way to a better future, we can't have faith. She had lost her hope. Until she heard about this guy walking around the countryside. This man of God, this prophet. Everybody who he came in contact with was changed. Everybody who needed healing was healed. She had her hope restored to the point that she risked being stoned to death in public by pushing her way through a crowd. I'm sure she was disguised because, you know, people would have known her. Poor Susie, the woman talking around the camp. Poor Susie, she's out there all by herself. They would have known her. She pushed her way through a crowd and touched the hem of Jesus' garment and was immediately healed. Jesus stops and goes, Who touched me? And the disciples are going, dude, there's like 1,700 people here. It could have been, I don't know, 300 of them. He goes, no. I felt virtue go out of me. Who touched me? And she, knowing that she'd been caught, knowing she'd been discovered, said, it was me. Now, this could sound like he's calling her out. It could sound like he's putting her on the spot. But no, he is loving her even in this. Because here's the thing. Even though she was healed, and only he and only she would have known this for the rest of their lives, that healing for her would have been tinged with just a shade of guilt because she would have felt like she stole something from the Lord. He called her out. He said, your faith has made you clean. There was a leper, same thing. A leper was unclean, except he had to dress as nastily as he could and yell, unclean, unclean, as he walked through anywhere. He came to Jesus and he said, Master, I know that you're able to heal me. I don't know if you're willing. He didn't have any hope. He had faith, but without hope to activate that faith. With two words, Jesus restored his hope, activated his faith. He said, I'm willing. Made him clean. Made him whole. Let's move on to faith. There was a time where I was working in Wisconsin. My wife was in Lawson. We lived in Lawson. She called me up one day, and she said, I cut the end of my thumb off. I said, really? She said, yeah. Now, I thought she could live without the end of her thumb. She thought it was a big deal. I said, well, okay, where's the end of the thumb? She said, it's on the knife. I said, finger cutting Phil. She said, yeah. I said, well, put the thumb back on your thumb. She said, okay. So she did. And I said, in the name of Jesus, be healed. She goes, it won't come off. I said, I know, right? She got to see that day faith actively working in her life. I didn't think much of it. Now, which is so odd to say. You put somebody's thumb back on their thumb from 1,000 miles away. Okay. I found out later, though, that that was instrumental in what happened when our last son was born. Our second to last son we had at home. And we tried to have the last one at home, too. But when the water broke, he'd pooped in the pool. He had meconium. There was a lot. And the midwife says, we need to go to the hospital. And I said, let me pray about that. I said, God, I have faith that you are going, or that you have everything under control. God said, that faith is well placed. Now go to the hospital. I said, oh, okay. We got to the hospital. Baby was born. Didn't breathe. For 1 minute, 2 minutes, 3 minutes, the baby didn't breathe. And the midwife said, Kathy, talk to your baby. And my wife said that having seen faith work in her own life, so having seen her thumb be reattached to her thumb, she knew that healing could take place, that life could come back. She said, God, don't take my baby. And then she said, baby, he didn't even have a name yet. He wasn't named for 3 weeks. Said, baby, this is your mama. Come back to us. And immediately, my son started crying. Hope leads to faith. Faith leads to love. But it's not just faith in believing that God has the power to do what you want him to do or what you're asking him to do. It's a faith that hope that we have for a better life, for a better world, that how God does that thing, how God gets to that better world, how God gets to a better place in our own lives, he has a better plan for that than we do. So when it doesn't go our way, do we have faith that God's way is better when we don't understand it? When it looks like all is lost, when it looks like everything is falling down around our ears. When that loved one dies, do we trust God? Great example of that, David. He saw this woman naked on the roof, bathing, had an affair with her. Her husband's name was Uriah. He tried to cover it up. She got pregnant. He tried to cover it up. He tried to get Uriah to go sleep with his own wife. Uriah was like, no, I got men back here on the battlefield. I can't take comfort if they can't take comfort. So he slept outside the door. And David was like, oh, okay. So he said, here's what we're going to do. He put Uriah up on the front line of a battle and had all of the rest of the army back off. He killed Uriah. God said, David, your son with Bathsheba is not going to live. David prayed and he fasted and he clothed himself with sackcloth and ashes. It's a traditional Jewish way to mourn. For weeks, said, God, don't take the baby. Baby died. David said, all right, now what? Let's get up. What's going on in the kingdom? What do you need to do to move forward? Everybody said, what are you doing, David? You need to mourn your baby. He goes, why? Baby's gone. I did my mourning beforehand. I did my prayers. I did my supplications. God had other plans. I'm okay with that. That's why David was a man after God's own heart. David loved the Lord no matter what circumstance he found himself in. We're going to talk about love, finally. This is going to be a short sermon. It's going to be a short sermon. When we talk about love, what we're not talking about in this context is the warm, fuzzy feeling of affection that we have one towards another, that we have towards a family member, even the romantic type of love that we have towards a partner. That's not what we're talking about. What we're talking about is not a feeling, but a decision. Now, I will say this as an aside. If you want to start an argument with your girlfriend, all you have to do is tell her, yeah, love's not really a feeling, it's a decision. Because she's going to be like, what, you don't love me? No, I do, but I decide to. This is written charity. So substitute love for charity. Charity is a higher form of love, essentially. This is what I'm talking about when I'm talking about love. Charity suffereth long and is kind. Charity envieth not. Charity vaunteth not itself, is not puffed up, doth not behave itself unseemly, seeketh not her own, is not easily provoked, thinketh no evil, rejoiceth not in iniquity, but rejoiceth in the truth. Beareth all things, believeth all things, hopeth all things, endureth all things. Charity never fails. This is the action that we are called to. And church, listen to me when I say this. If we are doing, it doesn't matter what we are doing, if we're feeding the poor, if we're clothing them, it doesn't matter what we do. If we don't do it with love, it means nothing. The beginning of this verse. Though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels and have not charity, I am become as a sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I could remove mountains and have not charity, I am nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned and have not charity, it doesn't profit me anything. If we are not invested in people's lives, we're not doing any good in the world. If we are not present with the people that we say we care about, we are not doing any good. I very much appreciate, thank you for coming. Thank you very much for coming. I very much appreciate these people in the back. Every one of them showed up simply because I asked them. Running up to this week, the last 6 weeks has been a hell. Every sin that ever beset me, every mistake that I've ever made came rushing back to say, you are not worthy to stand in front of these people. And I said, you know what? You're right. I'm not. But Jesus is worthy to be praised. And if I don't do it, it says the rocks and trees will cry out and praise him. And I am not about to be outpraised by a rock. Some of these people have acted more lovingly towards me than most of the people I find at church. There's a man here who, not that long ago, almost fell back into drugs. I almost ran headlong back into drugs. I said, hey, can you give me something? And he looked at me and he said, what are you doing? No. And I'll put you on the list of don't sell to. Thank you. I need that sometimes. I need somebody to look after me. I need somebody to act lovingly towards me when I can't do it for myself. Gene was supposed to be here. Gene had car trouble this morning. He was going to read a couple of poems. But Gene, I think it was 3 years ago. I was still living in a tent. He came to the bar one night and he said, I was thinking about you. And he handed me a stun gun, pepper spray, and a flashlight. A very, very bright flashlight. He saw a need. He met it. He's my brother. The other man is my brother. Not to say that I haven't been helped out by the church as well. I have. I've gotten, you know, Woody gave me work when I was down and out. Andy's been one of the best friends that I've ever had. We've had more discussions and more heartfelt, painful, humorous discussions than I've had with a lot of people in my life. Turns out, though, we're not necessarily called to like everybody. We're called to love everybody. We're called to treat people with love. We are called to act in love towards people. The thing is, when you act these ways, you can't help but start liking the people for whom you are acting. Jesus tells us, pray for those who despitefully use you. Do good to those who persecute you. Andy tells a story. Where his wife cheated on him with the donut man. I don't know his name. Doesn't matter. Doesn't matter his name. He was the donut man from down the street. Andy was so angry. He was going to kill him. He said, let me get this straight. I'm going to kill him doorknob dead. Was that the phrase? Graveyard dead. I'm going to kill him graveyard dead. And God said, you need to pray for him. And he said, I don't want to pray for him. I don't care if you want to pray for him or not. That's what I've called you to do. So he started praying for him. What's up, Ryan? Started praying for him. His prayer went something like, God, rain fire and brimstone down on his head. Oh, no.
The only reason I'm praying for him, because you said I had to, God, and you said that if you pray for your enemies, that you would heap coals of fire on their heads, so let the burning commence. And I know that's not the right attitude to have for it. Father, help me.
So he prayed for him, not with good intent, but guess what? As he prayed for him, God slowly started to change Andy's heart. Those two are now best of friends. When you start to treat people with love, when you start to do these things, you can't help but start to like the people for whom you're acting in love. So, in conclusion, we hope for a perfect world. We hope for a better life for ourselves, for a perfect life, for better circumstances for ourselves. We have faith that God has the power and ability to take us there. We have faith that God's way is better than our way. And we have love. When those two things are firmly ensconced in your lives, those two things lead to love. Love for God, love for self, and love for others. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Donny. Let's turn in our hymnal to 414. 414, we'll stand to sing this and remain standing for our closing prayer. Thank you. Father in heaven, we thank you for loving us. And we thank you for our brother Donnie reminding us to love each other and to love others as you loved us. We thank you, Father, for the ways that you have moved in our lives to restore hope, that our faith might be increased. And I ask, Father, that you continue to do so, for it is so easy to become distracted. I ask also, Father, in the name of Jesus, that as each one of us parts from this place, that your Holy Spirit would rest upon us to guide, direct us, protect us, and to lead us in our efforts to love as you would have us to love. We thank you, Father, for the experiences of life, even though some of them are painful, for making yourself known to us that we might have hope and faith. May all glory and honor be thine, Father. May your kingdom come on earth according to your desires. May your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. In Jesus' name, amen.